Hello, hello, everybody. We are starting early. Hi, Meatball. Hi, J Mortis. Hi, Pootie Twang. That is a hilarious username. That's awesome. Hi, Shitstorm is here. Sorry. Ashira Alchemy. Thank you. Well, thank you. I appreciate that. I'm glad that the puzzle pieces are coming together for you. Hi, Ivermectin. Hola. All right. So, I am now the proud owner of, as of today, 2 pieces of Best Friend's Mail. I wish that they would have sent me a different dog. Or maybe a hat. I wouldn't wear it, but, you know, whatever. Anyways, let's go ahead and get into it with this whole, Asher thing. Because I'm going to give you guys everything that I have found with the help of Echo Cat. We could literally study this family's history for months, and I'm not going to do that, okay? We're just not going to do that. There are people who dedicate their lives to researching British nobility and blah, 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 all that genealogy crap. But this family is so sus. But we couldn't have done it without Julie Castle, the current CEO of Best Friends. So I'm going to run the intro, and I will BRB.
Outside my window was a steeple with a clock that always said 12:30.
Forget, we are literally out here fighting demons, y'all. And hello, Gina G, Corey Anderson, May Brussel Project. Yeah, WTF indeed. Yeah, now I have 2. So thanks, but no thanks. And who else did I miss? Adriatic Sea Eyes. Hello, I don't know who you are. And I just hit something on the chat that I did not mean to, so that's great. All right, let's keep moving on. And Ivermectin, I don't believe that that's your real name. Hi, Tawny C. Hi, Claudia. Hi, Don Lambert. And okay, I think I'm all caught up. If I missed anybody, I apologize. All right, so I am going to, I guess, go ahead and just pull up the obituary. I didn't want to have it like running in the background because then the stream would be super slow. So I'm going to show you guys because, you know, they can't resist bragging. They just can't. And I'm going to kind of show you guys the adventure that I went on. And I also went on it with Echo Cat because what we ended up finding is just a lot more sus, quite frankly. Even though at first, like, I was a little disappointed, and I think he was too. But anyways, let me get this pulled up really quick so this way you guys can see for yourselves. Because again, all of the obituaries are only on the Best Friends website. Except I found Raphael Christopher, aka Father Lucius Nestor Raphael de Pyre. I found his and Eckoff, which I have on my Twitter. If someone will like remind me, I'll pull it up because I completely forgot about that. Hi, Angie Power Disney, and hi, Paul Kramer. All right, so let's go ahead and take a peek really quick. Okay, so remembering Diana Asher. All right, now this is literally, well, yesterday, I guess, would be a month, right? So there she is. And right here. Now, obviously, I'm not celebrating someone's death, so please understand that. I'm not happy that anyone died. Obviously, I have very strong opinions about these people, and I do think that they are very wicked. However, you know, we're going based off of what Miss Julie Castle put out here. You know what I mean? So I'm going to skip down right here. Let me keep going. Where is this about the Beatles stuff? So sus. Did she take it away? Okay, there it is. I was like, no. Okay, so right here. So Diana was born April 12th, 1946 in Eastbourne, Sussex, England. Her father was a schoolmaster and her mother an aristocrat in the line of the Duke of Cornwall. This is all true. It says Diana was one of four children, some of whom are accomplished musicians. I have only found one. Right here, though, it says famed music producer and performer Peter Asher of Peter and Gordon, who helped launch the careers of performers such as James Taylor and Linda Ronstadt, and actor Jane Asher, Paul McCartney's girlfriend of the mid-60s, were her first cousins. But celebrity meant little to Diana. She was all about the animals. Okay. And then down here, her earliest passion was dancing. She moved to London after high school to study dancing and acting for 2 years. It was the swinging 60s, and Diana was all in, from knee-high vinyl boots to miniskirt. Think Austin Powers. Soon after that, she met a group of friends who would eventually go on to start Best Friends. Okay, whatever you say, Julie, thank you for dropping the tea, ma'am. Seriously. All of that, red flag city. Duke of Cornwall, red flag. The Beatles stuff, red flag. You know, oh, she just happens to stumble upon these people. Okay. Whatever you say. Hi, Audra P. I haven't seen you in so long. Hello, Samantha. Oh, yes. Happy birthday, Dawn. Happy birthday. And let me make sure I didn't miss anybody else. Josh S. Hi, Jandon. Hello, hello, everybody. Thank you so much for being here. Okay, now, I'm going to show you guys multiple family members because this entire family is sus, okay? There's a lot of doctors, Pete and Jane Asher, their dad. There's a lot of weird stuff with him. There's a lot of weird stuff with his brother. It's just quite bizarre. But I'm just going to go through the PowerPoint with you guys. That way you can see it because I want you guys to see what I went through. But this is, I mean, hey man, Echo Cat went through it with me and I was like, welcome to the research, man. Like, this is how you find this stuff, especially with these lineage families. It's a real hellscape. It's a real hellscape. But we did figure it out because they are in the peerage and they are nobility. So let me get this popped up. Okay. So obviously, I needed to find her records, right? So what this looks like to me is at one point she was married to Gregory Castle. This is the only thing that I can deduce from that, is that she was Julie Castle, Diana Castle. This is my assumption. Obviously, this is 1996. I think that Julie and Gregory were together by that time. So not quite sure, as we know these people don't have a lot of public records. And then there is a Diana A. Castle, right? And there she is with a big fat pug. Look at those wrinkles. And here she is. Let me see if that'll work. Right. So it says Diana Asher with Harriet and her latest charges. So that's good and well. Now we'll go to the next one. Okay. So this is what I put on Twitter. I know it's a lot of repeated stuff, but whatever. I'm just showing you guys. So right here, this is her grandfather, Edward Granville Eddie Elliott. And he is indeed the Cornwall Unitary Authority. I don't know what a lot of this means, but we're going to be getting into it. And right there, so her real name is Anne Asher, okay? And her parents are Thomas George Horsey Asher and Susan Elliott. And this part right here, this is from the peerage, okay? Right there. So this is how we know that we're dealing with nobility. But let's take a peek really quick because, oh, look. Who else is his grandchildren? Jane Asher, Peter Asher, and Claire Asher. Imagine that. Wow. So maybe some of these, I don't know. I mean, I don't buy into the whole LaRouche thing about like this weird British plot to destroy America, but you know. There's kind of an argument. I mean, I think it's a battle between like the Vatican and, you know, maybe British aristocracy. However, and obviously, like, I don't endorse the anti-Semitism that LaRouche can get into. I'm not about any of that. However, like that whole British plot to like ruin the United States. I'm like, oh, I don't really know. Maybe. Hello, Tom Cooper. Hello, Desert Rain. So now let's look at these kids. Let's look at the cousins, right? Because she says that like all of these people are her first cousins. Yeah. So that is Peter and what is it? Jane and Claire. Okay. So you see little Claire right here. That's who I thought was Diana. Straight up. That's who I thought it was. Me and Echo Cat, we were really going for it. We thought that that's who it was, right? There's younger photos of them. There they are a little bit older. But as you can see, like, I mean, this family was a very big deal. And obviously, I mean, they still are. They're nobility, right? And there they are when they are very young. And then here's a quick little biography mentioning Claire, mentioning Jane. I think it's interesting that I don't know anything about the Asher family, but the brothers Karamazov, I love that book. So I thought that was kind of cool that she was in that. Let's go to the next slide. So here's Claire. Here's who I thought was Diana. Me and Echo Cat are like, this is her. Because I've told you guys, I've had to hold up pictures like of some of these processions next to other photos. And I'm like, this is her. Anyways, I'm not going to sit here and read all of this, but at least you guys can see, because this is Diana's first cousin, for sure. You know, it is what it is. I guess, you know, she was in one movie when she was younger, and then she was in one TV show later on in her life with her sister as a co-star. You know what I mean? All right, now, here's the grandfather. Yeah, and obviously you've already seen that photo, and this is just a long list of his family. Okay. This is going to be a little boring, guys, at least for the moment. So it is what it is. But I got to show you guys everything that I found. Okay. And right here, there is the notification of his death. And moving on. Yeah, this stuff is so freaking weird, dude. Okay. So first off, here's a clown outfit that he wore as a child. I don't know why. I don't know, whatever. I mean, these nobility families are just really obsessed with themselves. But here's a costume that was worn by him in 1885. He was 7 years old, and it was probably at a charity bazaar at Humphreys Hall in London's Knightsbridge. This is just, I don't really know what to tell you guys. That is the stuff of nightmares to me. Nope, we're good. We're done there. Now, this right here, so this is his papers, okay? Now, this, I think, is really fascinating, even though I couldn't get any access to them. So, this is basically a detail of his life. So, apparently, he was into, he worked as an actor and a playwright. And where did he got negative reviews? Hold on, I can't highlight it. Let me see. All right, right here. So, his musical play, Hide and Seek, opened at the Globe, London in December 1901, and it ran until January 02, receiving largely negative reviews. He then worked as a solicitor until the outbreak of war. In August 1914, he became a lieutenant of the Royal Naval Volunteer Reserve, in which he served until March 1916. He then became captain of the Royal Garrison Artillery until February of 1919. Blah, 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 blah. Nothing is known of his life after the war. Okay, that's not suspicious at all. Why? That's so weird. And then in 1929, like, people were making paintings of him here. And they were putting them on display at some, like, World's Fair. I don't know. I just thought that all of that was super sus. The clown outfit really freaked me out. I didn't like that whatsoever. Whatever. It is what it is. I see the chat moving. Let me say hi to everybody. Oh, hey, Echo Cat. I'm so glad that you're here. That's awesome. Let me see. With a hair bow. Yeah, I don't like that, that clown outfit. It really freaks me out. Some things knock the words right out of you. It's a tight-knit group. The apple doesn't fall far from the tree comes to mind. Companies housed to gov.uk is free to search. Hello, Jack and Paul Kramer. Asher developed his artist public persona. Yeah, I want to look and see what those papers say, because the whole, like, there's nothing known about him after the war. I just think that that's really weird. Obviously, he was already plugged in to, like, it would not be Hollywood, but, you know, some kind of scene at the time. I don't really know what it would be called there, but whatever. It is what it is. Now, let me get to... I really want to show you guys. I want to show you guys Peter and Jane's parents. The dad, mostly, because the dad is so suspicious. It's a lot. It's a lot. And then we'll get to Diana's family, because there's really not a lot about Diana's family, which is unfortunate, but I mean, it is what it is. So let me see. All right. So this is Jane Asher and Peter Asher's dad, Richard Asher. And I think that they did something to this guy. I'm going to be completely honest with you. When I was reading through the papers near the end, it almost sounds like, I don't know. I mean, I hate to say, like, MK'd him, because that's just such a generalized term, but I don't know. I don't know what they did to him. And it's weird, because he's in the same district as Dr. Stephen Ward from the Perfumo affair. He's in the exact same district. So that's also kind of weird. I mean, I get it, you know, whatever. It's a different time and obviously less people, but still, I think it's kind of weird that they're all in the same place at the same time. Okay, so this is the dad. So apparently, Dr. Richard Asher, you can hypnotize somebody and grow new hair. Yeah? So imagine that. I don't believe this whatsoever. I literally don't. But apparently, according to him, after 6 months, these two teenagers got their hair back. So good for them. Maybe that's why they took him out. If that's what happened, because you guys are going to see what happened to him. But, like, maybe they were like, oh, he actually figured that out. And then we're not going to be able to sell. What is that stuff that the guys put the powder on their heads? I don't know. I'm sorry. I just read that and I'm like, who's hypnotizing anybody to get their hair to grow back? It's ridiculous. So Fanny Adam Doctor, I didn't dig into this whole Fanny Adam thing, but the doctor who recently prescribed a sweet Fanny Adam tablet for people who just like taking pills is to serve on the government committee, which will check the safety of new drugs. He is Dr. Richard Asher, consultant physician at the Central Middlesex Hospital. He once asked doctors in the journal Medical World, is your prescription really necessary? If cheap, harmless tablets called TAP, Dulcis Fanny Adam & Co. were manufactured for patients who don't really need anything at all, it would save wasting real drugs, he said. 7 other medical and drug experts have been named with Dr. Asher as committee members. This is the most ridiculous thing that I've ever heard in my life. I'm just gonna give you pills because it makes you feel better. Like, literally, a placebo. And they granted that and published it in a medical journal. What the hell is wrong with these people? But him here, so right there where he's playing, all right, that's not going to kick me out. All right, so where he's playing Bill Basher, whatever, in some quartet. So obviously, he liked to act and sing as well, right? Imagine that. Now, this article, I couldn't get it the way that it was set up in the archive. This is how it looks, which kind of upset me because this seems very interesting. What are the 7 sins of medicine? I have no idea, but I had to throw it in here because, you know, I was very curious and I would like to come back to that now. Hold on. All right. So right here is where things get weird. Okay. So there's Peter Asher. Richard goes missing. This happens a couple times, and it's very bizarre. Where he goes, no one knows. Yeah. But obviously, you know, it doesn't look good for the family, right? So right here, you know, Peter's 18. That's all good and well. Oh, here we go. See? Right there. Son of Wimpole Street specialist, Dr. Richard Asher. Imagine that. But see, look. In this article about his dad going missing, it says Dr. Asher has been away for several weeks, and we are told he has not been well. It is hoped in due course he will return to duty. Okay, whatever you say. So that's 1964. Right over here, this is December 1963. So this is Jane and the Beatle. Actress Jane dates her Beatle. All right, so that's 64 and 63. Okay. Right here. Vanished Dr. Asher is home again. Okay. Dr. Asher will return in due course. This is all just really weird. It's just very bizarre. Why? Don't know. Just kind of bothers me. Like I said, it's just giving me weird vibes. Like, what was he involved in? Don't know. Maybe it's nothing. However, there is Jane. And there is Peter. And right here, this is 65, a marriage hint by Beetle Paul. And the mother says, we know nothing about this. This is unacceptable. Now, right here, this is March 7th, 1968. Guess who joined the session when Paul Jones cut his great new single, And the Sun Will Shine? Well, Peter Asher, of Peter and Gordon fame, produced the record. His younger sister Claire played the organ for it. His father, Dr. Richard Asher, joined in the chorus, and Paul McCartney played the drums. Jane Asher? Yes, she was there, with good advice. Only Mrs. Asher, a technician observed, was missing from the session. Okay, so that's what, March 7th, 1968. Now, okay. Goes missing again, and apparently unalives himself. Kind of weird, right? No. There we go. Okay, so right here. I couldn't even find the initial announcement of him going missing this time. However, now they're saying he's suffering from amnesia. He was just singing with Paul McCartney. What the hell are you guys talking about? What are you guys talking about? There he is. He's vanished. Oh my gosh, And then they say that he's dead. They say he was going to the library. Then they say that he OD'd on drugs. Then they say that he took his life in the cellar of his house. You see how none of this makes sense? You see what I mean? So he's missing. How long was he in the house? Huh? Why did nobody find him? I think that they did something to dude. But this is just my opinion. I think that that whole thing is extremely suspicious. I think it's very bizarre. Who knows? Maybe he knew something. I'm still of the opinion that maybe he did know how to hypnotize people to get their hair to grow. And maybe they took him out, you know, because of that. Because that's just a bit more of a lighthearted take to the whole situation. Because otherwise, it's extremely dark. It's extremely dark. Because who knows what happened to him? Whatever. That's it. He disappears from the papers. That's all good and well. Now, I want to show you guys. This is his brother, right? So I'm going to show you guys where I got this from. All right, I'm going to show you one slide really quick, and then I'm going to show you his brother, who is also a very suspicious doctor, who was also into some very weird stuff. But let me say hi to the chat really quick. Hold on. Hey, Paranoid American. Hello. Hello, my Cherie and Olani and Mr. Obvious and Tiger Lily. Manson called himself Christ. Yes, he did. That part of London gets stranger the more I see. Hell yeah, it does. Yes, it does. Absolutely, it does. Like, the more I see, especially coming back now, I'm like, oh, so, like, everybody was just being weird. Like, you got the whole perfume thing going on. He's hypnotizing people, getting their hair to grow back, and maybe somebody took him out. He's prescribing the fanny pills. Like, what did they call it? Like, sweet fanny? I don't know. I'm not going to pull it back up. But you know what I mean? Like, what the hell was going on in that district? Of course the process was going to thrive there. Of course. Now, let me pull this up really quick so you can see how I identified this as his brother, because there was some confusion initially. But, all right, so this is from one of those genealogical websites, right? Because these people are obsessed with themselves. So the guy that we just looked at, that's Richard Allen John Asher. I'm going to show you his brother, Harry Maurice Asher. But obviously, I wanted to clarify for myself. So that is their mom, right? And there is the census of all of them in their home. Because I am a major nerd, and you guys just don't know how much I enjoy finding all of this stuff and putting the puzzle together. Now, let's pull up this doctor, because this guy, don't have an answer for you. I'm just going to show you. His wife was also a really suspicious doctor that it seems she may or may not have been involved in the untimely demise of a infant. But we're not going to get into that today because I don't want to go there with my mind right now. However, I am going to show you this dude because he's next level. So this is his brother, Harry Maurice Asher. So right here, the day when Mr. Asher became two people. Okay. So let's see. The day he wanted to jump out of windows, the day time and distance became distorted. It was the day he became two people. He had a terrible urge to bite the deputy vice chancellor in the waistcoat. Okay. Oh, what did he take? What did he take? Oh, he took lysergic acid. Imagine that. Imagine that. Hmm? Lysergic acid, often referred to as LSD, has been found to produce in some people symptoms of schizophrenia or split personality. It is hoped that if antidotes to the effects of the drug can be developed, they may provide a cure for schizophrenia itself. And Mr. Asher agreed to be a test subject. He includes this experience in a book which is otherwise concerned with the mechanisms of the eye and research on sight. The reason, he says, is because while other authors have written whole books on the effects of drugs, he experienced effects more dramatic than any of which he had read. Wow. Imagine that. Kind of sounds like Jolly West, except for Jolly being like, I took acid and I didn't really trip balls and I was bummed out, so I didn't think it was a big deal. Durr. But I did find the book. So there it is, The Seeing Eye. And this was, I wasn't going to sit there and grab every single weird picture out of the book because we would literally be here all day. But there you go. The Spirit of the Greeks, the Seeing Eye. Lots of really, really intense visuals here. And quite frankly, not really trying to understand it. So that's the brother. So that's her uncle. Maybe like second uncle, uncle extended. I don't really know. Because again, like these nobility families, it's like, I can't deal with it. It's too much. Now, hold on. Let's go ahead and let's get to her family really quick. Let's get to her because there's not much on her because I do eventually want to show you guys this other family member of theirs that is super, super sus. Oh, I didn't take this out. Hold on, guys. Sorry, I gotta hide something because this is not part of this presentation yet, but it does have to do with the Presidio and the Mormons, the LDS specifically, and a secret society. We'll be talking about that next time. Now, let me get her pulled up real quick. I only found her in one paper, which is really frustrating, and it looks like she's very young, but it does line up as far as her being a performer. I don't have a matching name of the school, but that's okay. But I did at least find the records for, you know, Diana Asher, who of Best Friends just died early last month. So you guys have already seen the bottom. And again, that's her. Okay, mother's maiden name Elliot. We got it. And there's Anne Asher, 1952, in the East Kent Times and Mail, talking about some performance at the Holy Trinity School. Okay, that's all I have for her. And it sucks. It is what it is. It makes sense to me, though, if she got recruited very young, because that is what appears to have happened, right? I can't find anything. She doesn't exist. She just doesn't exist. I've looked up every single name. I've looked up every variation, and I always put in spelling errors as well, just to account for, like, because we've seen spelling errors in a lot of stuff, especially like old newspapers, right? So it is what it is. However, let me find the list of their chitlins. Okay, so this way I can show you her brother. All right, so now we're going to look at her parents and her siblings, the list of them, so I can show you the one brother that I've actually found. I have found birth records, technically not actual certificates, but I have found birth records of all of her siblings. But the one brother, big Carcosa energy, like straight up major Carcosa vibes. All right, so here we go. So Reverend Felix Asher, he was a clerk of the Holy Orders under the Vatican, just like Robert de Grimston's grandfather. Imagine that. Anyways, so right here are the children of Susan Elliott and Thomas George Horsey Asher. We have John, Anne, Charles, and James. I included Charles, John. I have two for John right here. But I included these right here, so at least that way you guys can see it. These people do exist, and we are not taking the nobility at their word, as no one should. As no one should. We have no reason to, right? I mean, at least in my opinion. Sorry if that offends anybody. I don't think that there's any nobility people particularly in my chat. But so me and Echo Cat are on this journey where we think that Diana Asher is Claire Asher. And I'm like, well, I find that in the peerage. And I find the siblings. And then I find her brother. And wouldn't you know it, he's hanging out with the nephew of J.R. Tolkien, Lord of the Rings, that guy, right? So this is even weirder than what I had anticipated, but here we go. So this is her brother, James Asher. So right there, he's born in 1950. And this is from 1971. So this says, David Tolkien, nephew of the author of the Lord of the Rings trilogy, and James Asher, who is a cousin of the actress Jane Asher, were walking the shoe to the new art emporium, whatever this outside shoe is. I don't know, and I don't care. These people are like so hob snobby, whatever. Anyways, but apparently these two live together. So it says, together with James, David lives in a house at Illfield Road, where the noise from James's drums and the piano of neighbor Michael Garrett is said to drive some of the neighbors mad. Imagine that. And right here, this is September 1st, 1979. You may recognize that gentleman. Second to the right, that is Mr. Pete Townsend. I can't quite figure out which one is her brother. However, so apparently this is, what is the name of this band? I had it right here. It's some sort of orchestra. Anyways, it's this girl, Angela Porter. Angela Porter. I didn't want to look into this because I think it's really weird that these two are, what is it? Eel Pie Productions? Whatever the hell this is, I don't know. I'm not trying to understand their music. However, these two were working together, putting together this orchestra. There you go. Angie's Orchestra. There you go. Okay. So that's super sus. Oh, and then, you know, right there. He also worked with The Who. That's from 1995. And there he is beating a drum. Okay. There he is beating the drum. Now, let's get into his big Carcosa energy. Oh, this isn't the slide. Well, let's just get to it right now. Right here. Look at this thing. Look at that. If you've seen True Detective, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Yeah? Because this gives off big Carcosa energy. And it's quite perfect that they add in a dog. A yellow dog, to be exact. You know what I mean? Yellow King? Yeah? Super, super weird. And I just thought that this little commentary was very bizarre. And I'm going to drop these links in the description of the video afterwards. Because this dude is actually very, very famous in this whole new age thing. But it says, despite the slight confusion when searching his name, James Asher has spent his life perfecting instrumental sounds for new age music. Though he is English, as far as we know, he spends his days far from espionage and political conflict. Okay. Instead, he spends his time producing, mixing, and creating music from all around the world. His love of music began at the age of 7 when he took up the violin. From there, he taught himself drums and piano before working up to creating his own music studio, Starfield. In 1988, he found himself near the top of the New Age Billboard music chart. Imagine that. But that, don't like that. Don't like any of that. Think that that is super, super sus, and I refuse to listen to his music, but here we go. So these are, whoops, dang it, there we go. Okay, so I on astrology, James Asher, colors of trance. What is that? Polychromatic meditations. Let's see, transmutation. Oh, like transmutation of the process. Yeah, Rhythmical alchemy? Okay. All right. Whatever you say, buddy. Whatever you say. And for anybody who's into the Chemical Brothers, I used to be. Apparently, his music was sampled in their song, The Sunshine Underground. And on the Eye for an Eye by Uncle. Don't know who Uncle is, but I definitely was into the Chemical Brothers back in the day. But yeah, this dude is extremely suspicious. I don't like it. I'm not going to listen to his music. I have absolutely zero interest in it. And now I'm going to say hello to the chat really quick. I'm not going to scroll all the way up. Hi, Carl Hassel. The Purple Rain is over and now all the bets are off. Tolkien and C.S. Lewis had their own little group called the Inklings. Did they really? That's very interesting. That is very interesting. Yes, Pete Townsend of The Who. That's right. He should have taken some of those anti-bald pills. He didn't do the pills. He hypnotized them. That was how they got their hair back. According to him, the world may never know. Is that why they took him out? Because he actually perfected that? Because I, you know, whatever. That's just a fun little adventure in my mind. Now, when Echo Cat and I were looking into this, because I really got to give credit to Echo Cat straight up, because like, he found a lot of this stuff as far as this weird, like, side quest with the Ashers. I don't know if you guys have heard of J.D. Souther. Now, these links I am going to have to pull up because it's just not going to function properly if I don't. That way you guys can see this. So J.D. Souther, EchoCat had told me and I confirmed it, was very good friends with Peter Asher. Well, come to find out, old boy is an ambassador for Best Friends. So imagine that. And this is per, what is this? We have the Kennedy Center right here. Yeah, he's on the Kennedy Center website. So this is all real, real sus. And I'll pull up the little slide that I made for him. That way you guys can see. But the process is everywhere, guys. All right. So if you know who he is, great. National Symphony Orchestra. Don't know. Don't know. Don't care. There you go. And right here. All right, so let's go ahead and just look for Best Friends. This dude wrote for the Eagles, which is really unfortunate because I do actually like the Eagles. A passionate animal lover and advocate, JD is also involved with Best Friends Animal Society. Souther proves his work holds up as well as Dylan's or Simon's or Lennon and McCartney's, blah, 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 blah. Okay, whatever. Let me drop this in the chat because we're going to get into some of his weirder interviews right here. That way you guys have it, because this dude, I will be coming back to him because I want to see exactly what he was involved in, because everything that he brings up is extremely suspicious. This is, which article is it? Hold on, because when I saw this one, I haven't found it. I have not found the claim that he makes in this article. I would like to find the claim. So if anybody does find proof of this, please let me know so that I can immediately come on here and I can show everybody, because this was very fascinating to me. But let me drop it in the chat first. Okay, so this is a random article that I found. And here we go. And I looked up every single album cover that I could find, and I had no luck. So the prize of, I don't know, I have no idea. I have nothing to offer you except for gratitude. However, this is from January 7th of 2020. And okay, so here we are. They're talking about him. He wrote for the Eagles, James Taylor, Bonnie Raitt, Linda Ronstadt, blah, 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 blah. Okay, now, here we go. You do a lot of touring these days. I don't have a normal schedule, but sometimes I go out for a few weeks. I pace myself. I love being home, and my life is very much wrapped up around my dogs. I'm an advocate for adoption and rescue. I've never had a dog that wasn't a rescue. I worked since the 90s with the Best Friends Animal Society. It's the biggest dog rescue sanctuary in the world. They're the ones instituting these no-kill shelter programs. All of my albums have a Best Friends logo on them. What? I would like to see this. I have not seen this. I cannot find them. But I would like them. So if anybody happens to come across one of these, because I've been like straight up like full-blown schizo, like looking at the album covers, seeing if it's like hidden in the imagery or something, like where is it, you know, is it like upside down or something, and I literally have not found anything at all whatsoever. It's, but there it is. I mean, how many demonic animal approval? Well, I mean, how many ties do we need? How many ties do we need? Seriously. Now, this one, I'm going to show you guys. Let me pull up the archive, and I'm also going to drop this in the chat because this is also a little bit sus, a little bit sus. But let me give this to you guys first. So Peter Asher married Elizabeth Marie Doster. Okay. I'm going to show you guys this slide, but I want to get that popped up. So what does she end up doing? Even though I think they split up, she ends up running her own animal charity as well. Imagine that. This is all becoming just a little bit predictable. This web archive gave me a problem last time. Hold on one second, guys. Nope, there we go. It's opening. Thank you. Yeah, because this is only in the archive now. If you actually look up their current website outside of the archive, it's a literal hellscape. Because they're functioning in a different way, according to the public. even though I don't buy it, where it's this just weird processian trying to manipulate like what some would call like Orthodox Christianity. I don't really care what people call it. I don't care what people believe, but it's very processian. It's very processian. But let's go ahead and take a look at this chick really quick, because I couldn't find too much on her, unfortunately. But it is what it is. So, right here. So this is, what is this? November 1970, Nashvillian marries in London. Miss Elizabeth Marie Doster and Peter Asher. Imagine that. Okay, so there she is, Elizabeth Doster Asher. She looked very beautiful. So she was a music industry insider and self-described political news junkie. She died December 18th, 2018 in L.A., and let's see, she worked in the coffee houses of New York's Greenwich Village and as a publicist before moving to London. Okay, who else had coffee houses? I don't know. By the time she relocated to LA, the musicians and songwriters she had known in the village had become household names in rock music. Blah, 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 blah. Betsy was passionate about animal welfare. She recruited her new neighbors to aid in her efforts to spay and neuter feral cat colonies in South LA and to find homes for stray dogs. Okay, whatever you say, sis. Yep, there they are. So they got divorced April 5th, 1983. But obviously, the Asher name is one that you might want to hold on to. Yeah, might want to hold on to that one. Now, let me pull up the other page for the archive. That way you guys can see her rescue that she opened. Creature Kind. Whatever. Here we go. There it is. And I haven't gone back all the way into the original capture of the archive. But here we go. Look at that. Imagine that. I'm not going to sit here and read everything, but here is their tribute to her. And this pretty much matches exactly what is in the newspapers. So obviously you guys can dig in for yourselves. This is all super sus though, guys. In my opinion, this is extremely suspicious. It's not a coincidence that all of these people are around the process, hanging out with the process, coming from these lineage families, and you just like expect me to believe that they all just happen to want to rescue animals? Okay. Okay. Whatever you say. I don't believe that whatsoever. But again, you know, it was Julie Castle that gave us all of that information where we were able to make that tie. And this is just like laying down, you know, the roots for this at the very least, because this is a direct line to a founder, to a founding member who just passed away. And I cannot understate the deep frustration that I have had and will continue to have with the Process Church of the Final Judgment, aka Best Friends Animal Society. Seriously. Because they keep dying off. They keep dying off. I didn't know that Eckhoff died. Oh, let me pull up my Twitter. Hold on. I forgot. Let me show you guys that. I didn't know that Eckhoff died. And then I found it. And so I was able to make a slide. But like, that's really frustrating. You're looking for these people. You know, you can't find them anywhere. And then come to find out they're dead. And again, I'm not here to exonerate anybody in the court of public opinion or in a court of law. I think that I've made that very clear. However, it is frustrating. Seriously, because the answers die with these people. I think that that's what people don't get. There's a lot of information that literally just dies with them. But let me pull this up. And it's Twitter, so who knows if it's gonna screw up or not. Now, I'm gonna try to say this delicately. There is a suspicion. And it is just a suspicion. That maybe this person's family or familial history ties into maybe not Germany during the war. So we'll just kind of leave it at that. And if anybody knows, if you could let me know, I've been looking. But here is Ernst Peter Paul Eckhoff. There he is. Imagine that. He's dead. Died in a car accident. Lots of car accidents. Because guess who else died in a car accident, I found out. Father Lucius Nestor Raphael. I might need a ladder for this reach, but it's just something to posit. Michael Vailcar III. Right? Yeah? Lots of car accidents. Could be completely unrelated. Who knows? These could be a bunch of geriatric processians who probably shouldn't be driving. Maybe that's the case. Who really knows? But if anybody is familiar with any of the names on this slide, please feel free to contact me. Because I would absolutely like to know. Because he's the only person that I have found where it mentions a tattoo, any tattoos on him. This is 1953, and, he's German. I'm not saying if you come from Germany that you are a Nazi. I'm not saying that. Don't get it twisted. I'm just saying it's an interesting name. There's an interesting, history with that name in Germany. But he's dead. Car accident. Surprise. Lucius Nestor, dead, car accident, surprise, Diana Asher, who knows? Who knows? I think thus far, technically, from the founders that went to Best Friends, the two car accidents are the only ones that, we actually know of, that we actually have answers, which is just really weird. I mean, you guys already know what I think. I want to know why the obituaries are not public for everybody, especially Marianne de Grimston. I really would like to know. The geriatric processing's good name for a band. maybe they would play it like a bingo hall out in Utah, hanging out with the Mormons, doing bingo, doing God knows what, quite frankly. But that's really what I have for now, guys. I'm not going to sit here and bore everybody with, a deep nobility history. It's a snooze fest, quite frankly. I have no interest in it. As soon as the peerage came up, I was like, okay, here we go. But at least we know now, right? Because we have Timothy Wiley's mother is buried in the city of London. That's a RSVP, you know what I mean? Let's see, who else? Robert de Grimston, he's nobility. And now we have Diana Asher. So that's three. That's three nobility families thus far. How many does it take to successfully cloak an intelligence operation as an animal sanctuary? Seriously. I don't know. The more that these people die off, the more that the history and the truth goes with them. And that's what's frustrating to me, because that's all that I care about. It's just very unfortunate, because it seems that Miss Diana right here, once you look at that and see how plugged in her entire family was and how pivotal her connection is to the Beatles, because now I have to come back. I don't have to. I'm just, talking. But now I got to come back and look at the Indica. It's the Indica bookshop, right? Or the Indica club. It's that place where they were all hanging out. But now I have the roots of it. You know what I mean? But now I think that this is going to help put those puzzle pieces together. Because this was really fascinating looking at this. And, like I said, it was me and Echo Cat. I wasn't super disappointed. Indica Gallery. Thank you so much, guys. You guys are so smart. I wasn't, super disappointed. I was for a second that it wasn't clear. But then when I saw her brother and all the weird music that he's doing and his weird True Detective Carcosa, you know, CD cover, and that's like his most renowned album. And I'm like, oh, this is worse. You know, and he's hanging out with the nephew of J.R. Tolkien. And I'm like, okay, all right. Well, I thought I wanted it to be Claire Asher. But no, no, I don't. I'm fine with it being Anne Asher. It's completely suspicious. But I will eventually come back to the Indica Gallery and try to, you know, pull it all apart. It's going to take a really long time, obviously. I have no idea when I will be coming back on or what I will be talking about. I may do just like a little kind of like chill, no research, like freestyle sort of thing. I don't really know. And then maybe I'll talk about some of the weird process stuff that I've found. Because I'm always doing research, guys. I'm always looking up stuff. And I have to like pick and choose. You know what I mean? Because I've got more stuff about Aquino and the Mormons. I've got a whole lot of stuff about Lewis Terman. Because I'm pretty sure that Lewis Terman had like this sort of like backdoor deal with one of these judges in Palo Alto at the time. And this guy that ended up becoming like a Mormon stake president. And it's just like stuff with like juvenile delinquents. It seems very weird. It's all very suspicious. So we have like a ton of things to get into. I just have to, you know, kind of sit down and pick, but that's on me. Mike, I don't want to say that out loud because I don't know if that is, but C-O-C-K-I-N-U was process member. Oh, well, thank you so much, Operation GCD. Thank you, garbage can dude. I appreciate it. How about a deep dive on Bobby Beausoleil? I have not gone in. I haven't talked about Beausoleil in a while. I really haven't. I talked about him a little bit, I think, on my Kenneth Anger episode. And when he did that interview with Truman Capote. Because I think Bobby Beausoleil is probably like one of the most level-headed individuals out of that entire situation. You know what I mean? I think that he makes a lot of sense. Doesn't mean that he's necessarily like telling the truth. But the interview with Truman Capote, I think, was, you know, relatively sound. Especially, you know, him kind of calling out the BS about everything, including about Sirhan Sirhan. So, Indica Gallery, John Dunbar. I have a really old PowerPoint with my Indica Gallery stuff. So I'm curious to see what I found then and where I'm at now, and then kind of cross-reference and dig through. Gina G. Also, before you go, I loved Virginia's video message in her blog. I dropped my phone. Oh, well, thank you, Gina G. I will be certain to tell her, absolutely. And hello, Franz Marks. And all right, guys. So I think I'm just going to leave it here for now. I will consider doing like a deeper dive on Bobby Beausoleil because I do think that there's something there. I'm very curious as to like the whole Getty thing because the Gettys were funding Kenneth Anger. Obviously, Kenneth Anger is super sus. The Gettys are like really big into the process or best friends, whatever you want to call it. They're the exact same thing. Don't care. Not allegedly. Send another piece of mail. Maybe include a hat instead of just sending me these silly little flyers. But I mean, like, I don't know. Were these things set up that far in advance? I just don't believe that there are that many coincidences. I really don't. Especially because, like, with Kenneth Anger and he's hanging out with Kinsey and they're going to the Abbey of Thelema. And it's just like, I don't buy it. I don't buy it at all. So, yeah, maybe we'll come back and maybe I'll do a bit of a deeper dive because I feel like when I talked about Kenneth Anger, I didn't really go that far because that like wasn't my focus. I was just trying to get through the timeline. And obviously I've learned a lot more now. And we do got to bring the Gettys into the picture because the Gettys love best friends. They freaking love them. Right? And that's interesting. Yeah, I think it's super fascinating. So I don't know. Yeah, that's a good idea. Yeah, absolutely. I'll come back and we'll start over with that. Not start over. Don't anybody freak out. Because I'm still starting over with the Son of Sam. Don't forget. Okay. Definitely starting over there. But we'll come back with fresh eyes. Reevaluate the Gettys and all of these other, you know, the bourgeoisie, whatever people want to call it. I will catch you guys on the flip side and be safe.